Yeah, thanks for the introduction. My name was already said. I'm Ignaz Forster. I'll be talking about transaction updates today again. This will be another talk about them. I hope you can still hear it. The last talk I've been doing about that was 2 years ago. So in those 2 years, there have been a lot of changes. But the actual trigger for this talk is, just a second. You can switch. That we now have a SLI product which actually contains transactional updates as a core component. And that SLI product is SUSE Linux Enterprise Micro. That's just one of the systems we have in our portfolio which share some mechanism. The other systems we have are on the OpenSUSE side, OpenSUSE Cubic and OpenSUSE Micro S, but our regular systems like the SUSE Linux Enterprise Server or Tumbleweed or Leap. Those also provide a transactional server role or a transactional server module, which will also put those systems into read-only mode. But transaction update itself is basically just a package you can install in any of those releases. So if you should ever have to test or debug something, you can just install it on basically any system. The interesting thing is most of all for read-only systems. So that's what the focus will be on in this talk. Lately, I've been getting a lot of questions about how transactional updates are actually working because people are starting to get more and more bug reports for their components. That's basically what this talk is trying to do, get an overview of what transactional update is and how it's operated. Those of you who know transactional updates already may be a bit bored by the first part of the talk, because I'll reintroduce the concept just to see why things are done as they are done today. But I still hope there will be some interesting points because, for example, we have the all-new ETC handling. And yeah, I hope it will be a refresher at least. The fun part for those of you who know transactional updates already is the what's new part, because there have been a lot of changes in the last 2 years. And I'll be talking about those in the second part. If you have any questions, I'll try to watch the chat on the side. If there's too much discussion, I may not be able to follow. So I try to reserve some space in the end anyway. So let's start with the most exciting part ever, namely a definition. We had a talk by Richard yesterday about our customers actually using SLI Micro already. So that read-only operating system is something which our customers actually want. So you also heard about the definition of transactional updates, I guess, multiple times already. You've probably been beaten to death with it. But let me just repeat it once more, because there's one important thing I want to say. A transactional update, let's start with the definition, is an update that is atomic. So an update either has to be fully applied or not applied at all, but we never want to have any state in between where an update, for example, is only partially applied. And the important part, which I will come back to later, several times, the update must not influence the currently running system. That's one of the basic design principles of the mechanism is built around, and that explains a lot of the decisions why things work, how they work later. The second part is a transactional update is an update that can be rolled back. So if anything goes wrong, we can always roll back to a previous known well-working snapshot. One thing to say is that that's a very generic definition, and it's not only valid for OpenSUSE, or SUSE. It's also valid for other products, for example, on the Fedora or Red Hat side for CoreOS or for Ubuntu Core or for Mender in the embedded world or whatever. In this talk, I'll focus on the OpenSUSE and SUSE side, of course, but just so that you know, a transactional update or a transactional system is nothing specific to SUSE in the first place. But if you have a look on the SUSE side, we have several components which we are using for our system management. That's basically Zipper for packages, Snapper for our snapshot management, and we have BTRFS as our default file system. Those are the core components a transactional update is basically built around. You could also say transactional update is just a wrapper around those core components. That's, by the way, contrary to the other distributions I just told you about. Those have new ecosystems basically for handling their transactional systems. While on SUSE, you can just use existing components without having to change your infrastructure. So I guess everybody is aware how an update actually works. Usually you are just calling, for example, super up. What then happens is you will get the snapper component. There's a snapper plugin for super. We'll just create a backup snapshot before the update is performed. Then the update itself is performed in the currently running snapshot, and then we get another snapshot at the end. So far, so well known. Just a second, how updates work, packages go in, OS comes out, you can't explain that. on the transactional update side, that's basically inversed. We have a stack of previous snapshots, and we have the currently active system. So if you want to create a new snapshot, Snapper will create that new snapshot, and then Zipper will basically be performed within that chroot environment to perform the update in there. If anything goes wrong during that update, no harm is done. Like I said, the currently running system must not be influenced. So if anything goes wrong during that update, that new snapshot can just be discarded again and nothing happened basically. If the update was successful, that new snapshot will be set as the new default snapshot, and we have a new snapshot in our stack. The snapshot is activated by actually rebooting the system, so then we can actually use that snapshot. We are talking about read-only operating systems when we are talking about SLEE Micro, for example. But in reality, we've just seen that in Ludwig's talk too, we have a lot of directories which are actually read-write. So when I'm talking about snapshots, then I'm always talking about the root file system. We have several other directories, and some of them I'll pick out now because they need some special considerations. For one, that is var. Var contains variable data. We just heard that from Ludwig's talk. Var is a directory which can't be snapshotted basically, because it contains, for example, Docker images or databases, and that can not be part of the root file system at all. And like I said, it can't be snapshotted. But the problem is that we also can't modify var from within an update environment. Why is that? Because in the update environment, we can't modify the existing data from the currently running system. So one takeaway is var cannot and will not ever be mounted in the transactional update environment. If some package has to perform an operation within var in a postinscript script or whatever, then that can't be done. if something has to be done, that has to be done from the next boot, usually typically by a systemd service, which will then do the changes which are required. A similar thing is the etsy directory. We just heard a lot about it in Ludwig's talk too. Etsy, as it currently is, also has to be writable. We try to get rid of that, but as currently we have the situation that it still has to be writable. But in contrast to var, we can do snapshots, or we can bind the contents of etc to a certain specific snapshot. So what we are basically doing is we create one snapshot, one overlay directory per snapshot. Now that raises several questions, I guess. Why do we need overlays? The reason is we want to have changes which are done between the snapshot is taken and the time the system is actually rebooted to still apply to the new system. That's one of the principles we had when designing the system. And yeah, that's the reason why we have those overlays. On the other hand, we have several problems because of those overlays. One of the problems is that we can't take a snapshot of the system at the time the overlay is created. So you can see that strange formula there. The contents of etsy is basically the state of etsy of the new snapshot, which is basically the snapshot before the currently running snapshot. Then we have this overlay of the snapshot which is currently running, and the overlay of the snapshot which will then be booted. That's quite complicated, because if you would delete the overlay directories, you would basically end up in a state before the current snapshot. That has technical reasons, because we can't sync the overlay file system of a system which is still running, because we couldn't detect changes of that of the current overlay in the new overlay as soon as the new system is running. That also raises another question, another problem, that we have two overlays, and only one overlay can win if a file should be present in both overlays. For example, let's say the administrator is still modifying, or not only just the administrator, it may also be the system configuration software or whatever, may modify a file, but that same file was also modified by a package during the installation. So basically, we would have a situation where the overlay of the currently running system contains a modified copy of that file, but the package management software has also modified the file in the overlay of the future snapshot. Basically, only one file can win. That would be the file of the new future snapshot, and the current state would just be overwritten. And that's the point where I can just refer back to Ludwig, which makes it really good if those packages would not write their files into etc anymore, because then you wouldn't have that problem of somehow synchronizing those states. In general, we have the transaction update guide. If you want to know a lot more about that, you can also read the guide, which has a more detailed explanation of everything. Another question I got quite often lately is, how can we escape that update environment? Because we want to transfer state information into the currently running system. And just think back, that's why I was telling you about the definition again, that's not what we want, because you would always modify the currently running system, which is usually not a good idea. So I've created a list here of all the files which are actually bind mounted into the update environment. And you can see that's more than we wanted, but basically not a lot of relevant stuff. For every chroot environment, we need dev, proc, and sys, of course. We also have varlog and varcache bind mounted. Varlog, of course, because we don't want to lose logging messages, which maybe were created during the update. We have slash root mounted, not the root file system, but the home of the root user, because if, for example, the user will just open a shell, we don't want to lose the history of that user. We have etc mounted, like I just said, with the restrictions that you will only get new files or a new overlay. So in the currently running system, you won't see the files you create in there. Then we have several directories, which are basically workarounds about existing limitations, let's say. Especially the last one, varlib se linux, is really hurting a lot because that's really a major breakage out of that isolated environment. That would be something we really have to fix in the future. Regarding the boot manager, of course, we also have to keep the part which is part of the boot sector and the part which is on disk in sync, so we have to mount that. That also can be snapshotted, obviously. Snapshots just for management so that we can just check them. And that's it about the hard-coded things. We also have a new addition, namely a configuration variable named bindDirs. If you think you need some more data in the snapshot, you can add additional directories here. By default, that's opt. Usually it's not a good idea to actually do that, because what we are basically doing is you expose the things which are done in that update to the currently running system. Let's imagine a software which was installing to opt. The software will immediately be available from outside the transaction update environment without having that reboot, so that only atomic part we have, which may work if the application is completely installed in opt. If it's distributing files into other directories too, then we have a wild mix of files which may or may not be available from the currently running system. So whenever you use that, please make yourself aware of the consequences you have when you do that. So that's most parts of the existing software stack. I'll just have a short look at the question section, at the chat. I think I'll try to read that later. So let's talk about the new things that have changed since the last talk. What's new? Basically everything. The good thing is that's mostly just in the background under the hood. The interface itself stayed the same. So the most prominent change, I guess, or the most desired change is we had a huge bash script before, and all of the logic, the things which are really doing the more difficult things are now rewritten in C++. That has several reasons, but the thing that just fell out of it without having to do anything, we now have a library which can perform transactions. It's a generic library called libtoolkit, TU for transaction update, which can just perform any operations. I'll just go into more detail on the next slide. Then we have tukit as a command line application, which will basically just wrap those commands we have in the library and make them available to the command line. And we still have the transactional update script. Like I said, we don't have any change of the interface, but I reduced the functionality of the transactional update script to just contain the SUSE-specific stuff. What that means, we'll just see in a few seconds. And the fourth thing is we now have a dbus interface, which is basically also just a wrapper around the libtoolkit functionality. So if you want to perform transactions, I try to define just a very generic interface. If you're a developer, I thought, what would you want to do if you want to perform anything within a transaction on a transactional system? So basically, we just have very few methods. That's basically in it, to open a new transaction. That's execute and call ext to execute anything in that transaction, and we have finalized to close that transaction again. Execute and call ext are basically doing the same thing. In both cases, they will just mount all the mounts into, create a new snapshot, mount everything in there, and call an arbitrary command. There's just one exception. Call ext will not ch root into the root environment. That may be necessary if you, for example, want to copy a file from the live system into the ch root system. If you are a clever mind, you may get the idea that you could abuse that. I won't be able to stop you, but I didn't say that. By default, if a transaction is not finalized and the transaction object, like I just said, it's a C++ library, if it's just closed again and the destructor is called, the transaction will be deleted. To prevent that, just like I said, either finalize it or say keep. Then it will be kept in the pending state where it's not set as the new default snapshot yet. And you can resume that later if you decide you have to do some other tasks. The only documentation we currently have is the header file itself. I think the documentation is quite okay, but of course we need a more detailed website for that in the long term. We also have C bindings. So yeah, you don't have to necessarily use the C++ library. And we have the first user of the library already, which is basically a plugin for DNF, the package manager usually used on Fedora. DNF can manage or can work with the transactional OpenSUSE system by now. And we are actively using that already with the MicroS desktop, if you ever want to try that. There seem to be some problems left, but I think it's not related to the library itself. The library, if you have a look at the method names, is quite generic. I hope, at least. So in general, we are not limited to Snapper and B3FS. Basically, it's capable of supporting more transactional systems if we wanted to support them. So yeah, that's the library as it currently is, basically. Like I said, we also have tukit. It's a binary, which is just a wrapper, a command line wrapper around the libtukit functionality. The only difference is if you call execute, you will basically have a combined init execute finalize or init execute and nothing else, call the destructor basically, if anything fails. But you can call all of the functionality also in a fine-grained way if you want. What I haven't been writing here is please don't use tukit just yet, because it's currently missing two functionalities, which make it not so good, but I'll come back to that later. Then, like I said, we still have the transaction update command that will wrap all these SUSE specific commands. You've seen the interface itself will basically just call commands. If you want to call superdub, just an example, in a transactional environment, you would just call transactional update dub, and that in the background will just call tukit call superdub. That's the complete magic that is left for the transactional update bash script. It's just a wrapper around tukit, basically, wrapping all those SUSE-specific commands we have, including refreshing the bootloader and rewriting the grub configuration and what else we might have. Like I just said, there are two things that haven't been migrated to the library yet, and that's the cleanup mechanism and the rollback mechanism. And the cleanup mechanism is why you shouldn't be using it just yet, because otherwise you'd have to clean up manually, because the snapshots currently won't be marked for cleanup. Please wait for the 4.0.0 release. That should be very soon. I tried to have the release ready for this conference. Unfortunately, I didn't make it. And the last component is the new DBus interface, and this is where I'll just switch to screen sharing now. In a few seconds. So I hope you can all see the screen now. We can just call busctl a systemd component and check what we have. What we see is we have basically all the functionality from the library also exposed via dbus. And you can also see you will receive signals. And I will just switch back to the presentation now. Because I don't have the correct slide yet. Just a second. Yeah. And you can see the asynchronous responses. The reason why we can't just wait for the command to finish is because we don't know how long it will actually take for those commands to run. If you're doing a super update, you know that that can be quite long, especially on Tumbleweed. But dbus has a default timeout of 25 seconds. So basically, we just have to return the result via signal. You can just see the command. I guess if you're using dbus anyway, you know that. You can just introspect the interface. And I just noticed, by the way, that dbus doesn't have any logo, so I had to create one myself. The other news is the major simplification of the ETC overlays. So you may still remember that overly long lines we had in the past. The line I'm showing here is very short. In practice, those are usually way longer because in the past, we used to keep all the overlays up to the oldest still available snapshot. And that could be a very old snapshot, unfortunately, especially if someone created a snapshot manually and it was never deleted. And that caused several problems. For example, the length of the command line would be exceeded and it wouldn't be mounted anymore at all. So what we are basically doing now is we are just assuming that the administrator can go on, can go back only one snapshot. So if you do a rollback, the updates would still be applied, but not if you go back several snapshots. You may still get more overlays if you use the continue option, because then we don't have anything to go back yet, but that's not the default case if you're having an automated system. So what else is new? I just mentioned previously that we have mounted an SE Linux directory, and that's because we have SE Linux support now. That should be 2 points. That should be 2 points. We have SE Linux support and we have IMA support. That should be set up IMA. Oh, sorry. I'm confused. I'm confusing myself. Just a second. Back. Setup SE Linux is correct. We also have IMA experiments, but setup SE Linux is correct. Sorry. if you want to set up a system with SE Linux, you can just call transactional update setup SE Linux and you'll get everything you need installed and set up automatically for you. Another new component, which is unfortunately still experimental, is the status command. Alberto was working on that. We wanted to get an overview of the system, which packages are installed, which packages are not, what is expected. But unfortunately, especially on SLI Micro, that didn't work as expected yet. So that's just an experimental thing. You can enable it. You can just also call it and see what's happening. We'll explore that in the future in a more detailed way. We also have partial kernel live patching support now. Partial because of that, you can do live patching. That's no problem in general, but you won't get the info. That will still need some thinking, but in general, live patching is working if you add the kernel live patching module. And there have been a few other smaller things, especially transactional update quiet is really quiet now, which means you can use it to just get the outputs and only the output of your command and no messages by transactional update itself, which may be useful if you're using it in an automated environment, for example, in Salt or SaltStack. Another point is we are not mangling STDR anymore. All the messages will get into the correct output channel now. That may be important also, mainly for automation. So I've been talking a lot now. All of the things I've been talking about are available with all the distributions I just mentioned, both in SLI Micro, in Tumbleweed, and in Tumbleweed. No, it's not available in the current lib yet, except for the Dbus interface and the C interface. Those haven't been released yet. The Dbus interface is using the C interface, by the way, because I wanted to have a real test case method that actually works. If you want to do some pre-release testing, you can use my private OBS branch for that. Or you just skip those two and check TUKit without the current Dbus functionality. Another major blocker which is still preventing the 4.0 release is I haven't finished snapshot management yet, which is supposed to do something similar like what we currently do for transactions. So basically, you can just say, give me a list of open snapshots, or give me a list of snapshots in general. And we can do that also in a very generic way, because currently, due to our B3FS and snapper knowledge, we also know how to handle snapshots. If we wanted to ever implement anything else, you could also just implement that functionality in here. It's not, snapshot management is not something which would be SUSE specific. So yeah, that's the plan. And we need it anyway, because for Cockpit, we want to also have update support. And for that, we have to be able to select snapshots. Like I said, not everything has been migrated from transactional update yet. Basically, the cleanup and rollback mechanism, those still have to be migrated into TUKit. And one of the major things which should be done before the release, we need a man page. And for TUKit and a website for the complete API. So that's it basically. If you want to contact us, you can find us on the OpenSUSE-Q Week mailing list in OpenSUSE.org. If you want to discuss something internally, we are in Discussly Micro on Slack, or just open a bug against Micro as a transactional update as a component, either in Bugzilla or on GitHub. So that's it basically. I guess I'll just try to scroll through the chat and pick up all the questions I may have missed, or just ask them. Dario, regarding the question or regarding my don't use TUKit saying, you can use it, and especially you are supposed to use it on the MicroOS desktop, because that's a core component of the MicroOS desktop. What I meant was, please don't use the TUKit command manually yet, but you are correct, on the MicroOS desktop, you still have to clean up the old snapshots manually currently. That's indeed a limitation, but you obviously have to use it if you want to use the PK the package kit integration, basically. So I think.
Yeah, and thanks for answering. And just to clarify, I wasn't implying that it was your fault in any way. It's just it was just a comment. And yes, and in fact, if you like try a MicroS desktop and check, there are a lot of snapshots that are not cleaned up, which I guess it's the reason what you just said. Thanks.
My pleasure. So, I hope that explained some things to some people. If you had any questions, and if there are no further questions, we may be 4 minutes early.
Okay. There are some questions whether the transactional update reboot or not full reboot can be somehow sped up by not, for example, not rebooting the whole machine, just key executing kernel.
Transactional update has several reboot methods which can be triggered automatically. And one of those reboot methods would be kexec. So you can just skip the BIOS part at least. Dario also replied.
Yeah, and then there was...
And Thorsten.
There was a recommendation from Daniel Wagner about, you mentioned that you have DBus APIs where you the duration of the requests can be longer than the DBus timeout, and that you use DBus signals. And Daniel recommended, I actually didn't get it exactly what he recommended, to look at some other DBus services to see how they do it. But I think the signals are the way to do it. So maybe if Daniel wants to clarify.
Like the agent API. Maybe I should add that cockpit itself requires DBus, so we have to use DBus if we want to have cockpit integration. I'll have to check about the agent API. I haven't heard about that yet, and see whether that may be helpful to avoid sending signals. Okay.